at Snow College. Ooh, I don't even know if we want to count the years. 89, 90, 91, you know, probably before you were all even conceived, right? So way back. Okay. Dustin has gone a lot of different directions during his life. He's a game designer, he's an illustrator, he's an author, he's an entrepreneur. Dustin Hansen, a Snow College alumnus, 89 through 92, has been working professionally as an artist in the video game, toy, and film industries for nearly 25 years. He spent 15 years of that time with Electronic Arts as their senior creative director, where he set the visual goals for the products like Madden Football, NBA Street, The Sims, and many more. Dustin joined Hasbro in 2014 as their director of new products and innovation, but missed the snowy mountains of Utah so much that he relocated back to Ephraim. If you can imagine, Ephraim is a great place, right? Shortly after. Dustin is currently working as the senior concept artist for the Void VR theme park developed by a development group in Linden, Utah. He is also a newly published author, as you can see right here. He is also in the love letter video game history, his love letter to video game history, Game On, and his highly illustrated chapter book series, Microsaurus, have opened up a new chapter in Dustin's life as a writer and an illustrator. Please help me welcome Dustin Hansen.
Same time that layout goes to the background painters who paint that because you can imagine, you know, the balance between trying to get all those things to line up at the same time. Things have to run concurrently. So layout becomes kind of a guidepost that gets used for background and animation. And then nobody ever sees your art, like, ever. Your layout guy, the only people see are the animators and the background painters. So I did that for a little while, and then I got back into video games in 1998 when I joined up with EA. And I was with EA for a long time. I love working with them because they're really aggressive as far as fundamentals, making sure that they hire artists who understand how to draw first and teach software later, which is, believe it or not, kind of a rare thing in the video game industry, or was then. I think it's changing. But I, at EA, I've worked in most of their studios. I spent quite a bit of time in Florida at their Tiburon studio with their sports projects. I lived in San Francisco for a while working on Sims and Dog Father Project and another project that I worked on some of EA's terrible projects as well as some of them on there. I worked with them for quite a while, and then I just kind of had the itch to get back into something else. And that's kind of been me, and you'll kind of see it even through this art stuff. I like to kind of set something new and kind of try to push myself visually and try to do new things. And through my work at EA, I've met Hasbro, the toy company, and I worked with them on some Hasbro/EA projects. And somehow they talked me into moving my family across the country to Rhode Island. Actually, I worked for them for 2 years from here at Ephraim first, doing remote work, and then I ended up moving here to join them at Rhode Island to work on it. I was director of new products and innovation, which is silly, because really what it was I was just a painter, and they brought me in and let me kind of work with these kind of weird harebrained guys, and we drew lots of pictures and made lots of movies and kind of goofed around and got to work with weird people like J.J. Abrams, and people would kind of hang out with you for a couple of days and blow your mind. So that kind of brought me, in Rhode Island, decided Utah was kind of where we really wanted to be. It wasn't really my decision, but I'm outnumbered in my family. I love Rhode Island. I love being there. Hasbro is a super, probably the most fun job I ever have. Lots of freedom. But it wasn't working out family-wise, so we moved back to Ephraim. We never sold our house, so that helped. We moved back, and I started just contracting, which I've done throughout the years. I'll take a couple years off and contract. And so I started contracting, and it was fun working with a lot of different people. And then I bumped into this group in Linden, Utah, called The Void. Have any of you guys, raise your hand if you've heard of The Void? So what The Void is, really quick, and then we're going to work hard. What The Void is it's a virtual reality thing, right? You just put on something similar to the Oculus Rift. We build our own hardware from scratch that's much more high resolution, has a wider viewing angle. Plus, we wanted to integrate like high-quality audio and a few other things. So you put on a helmet with ears and eyes. We steal your ears and eyes. You put a backpack on your back that has full motion sensors, so you can do full motion capture live while you're walking through the experience. But the really great thing about it is that it's actually built in a physical space. In that physical space, if you see a wall, you reach out in virtual reality and try to touch that wall, it's actually there, right? So the best way to think of it is it's like a black box theater, where we can shift the walls around physically. And then we built a CG computer-generated world to sit over the top of that. And it's been a really fascinating thing because it is super innovative. It's like we're kind of the only guys doing this. And it's been super fun for me because I don't go to any meetings. I literally sit and paint all day. And they're like, hey, how about this? And I get a painting. So selfishly, it's been like really creatively fulfilling. And The Void is getting lots of interest. So I'll be really interested to see kind of what happens through The Void. So what I want to do today on art-wise is I'm going to show you about 150 images here real quick. So we're going to go through really fast. I'm happy to go back and hit them after if you want to kind of dig into specific images or questions about some of these things. I'm going to show you some projects that they haven't been released yet, like this one. I think this one just got canceled. That happens all the time. More projects get canceled than get shipped. In the film industry, it happens all the time. If you're a concept artist, probably 99% of the work you do will never be seen by anybody outside of your studio. That's just kind of the way it is. So that's kind of an interesting thing. So I've changed the name on all these little titles. They just have kind of like keywords. Someday in the news, if you see the news, you go, oh, that one was that one. Except for one. One, you know, I couldn't really change the name on. So what I wanted to show you is this is about a third of the amount of work that I do in a year. So this is 2016. Everything here we've done in a year. And I did about 300, a little over 300, around 350 pieces this year between my book stuff and my work stuff. So that kind of tells you how many days in a year, which you could average how much time I spent on a piece. Not all of them are this about finished, right? This is kind of rare. So, anyway, does this thing work?
We used to.
Oh, it does. Right away. All right. So what I wanted to kind of show you is stuff starts off pretty rough. Right, like so. This is really common. So what this garbage is, and this is kind of garbagey, right? Like this is the kind of stuff where I do, where I'll sit in a meeting directly, either drawing directly on an iPad Air, which is what this was done on, or if it's going to be a long enough protracted meeting, I'll just bring my Cintiq in so that I can talk in during the meeting, and people, you know, designers will kind of talk about what they want, and I'll live sketch. So some of these things, you know, these are like between 10 and 20 minute pieces. Sometimes a lot faster. This one's probably a lot faster. So they're pretty common, and I'll usually, in a meeting, do 20 or 30 of those in one kind of a long kickoff meeting. So we'll block off a half a day, we'll sketch, we'll bang things out. I used to do it on paper, now iPad Air's a killer tool for doing that kind of stuff, because I can just walk around anywhere and do it. And from that, I'll go back to my desk and I'll kind of refine things. So this is pretty common for me to do these, like, real quick. And they really only communicate to the art director on the project and the designer. Like, if I can get to a point where they're like, yeah, that's it, or no, that's absolutely not it, then the piece is done. Like, so I don't finish polish a lot of these things. From something like this, they can say, I actually want to see the opposite angle. So then I'll do the same kind of thing, like, real quick. So this is kind of looking from the opposite angle in this big, massive room, right? Then shift it back. So now you can see I've gone from that one to kind of this one, right? So this sketch is one where they're like, okay, that's it. That's the right shot. It kind of communicates what we want to get from this thing. I wish I had a pointer. This stuff. Get the mouse. Oh yeah. Hey. So this stuff right here is a physical wall in the void. The skeleton would be something that would be physically in the void, you know, like that actual model that would sit on the floor. This wall here is something that is a physical wall, and this doorway that is closed but open is physical. The rest of that stuff you would replace with something kind of visually cool, right? So to get to that point, this is a good success, right? Like, to me, it's a pretty quick sketch. You know, it's pretty accurate perspective-wise, so they can get an idea of what it will look like. And then we go, I'm out of here.
Oh boy.
And, oh, don't tell me we have to hear the beep every time.
That would be fun.
And then, you know, kind of same thing. Continue refining. And so still at this point, I'm probably two or three days into a piece. Right? Lots of sketches, literally hundreds thrown on the floor before I get to a point. So to me, this would be one that I would count as this is a fairly big stage for them. This one was good enough to a point where I could actually spend a little bit of time on the piece. I don't know what I did. Hang on. We're going to run it one more time. Play from current slide. PowerPoint is my enemy.
Yeah.
I can see that. All right. We'll play that again. All right. We're there, right?
Yeah.
So then I get to a point where I'm actually painting, right? So this is a pretty good example. Certainly not finished. As you can see, like, I've got roughed in block stuff. And all this stuff I actually do in 2D, 100% of it in Photoshop. I'm kind of making that transition where I'm starting to use some 3D elements into my stuff because it's faster. But for me, it drives me nuts. I'm just not used to that process. But it's an amazing process. Most of the concept guys I work with do use 3Ds to, like, build like mock models that they paint over. It's an awesome process. It's just, I'm kind of old school dude, so I draw fast. And just to kind of show you, like, resolution-wise, if you look up and see those little doves at the top, like, they're really high resolution. So these are like 30 by 40 inch printed out pieces. This one I actually did take to finish. I don't have the finished one with me here, but you get kind of an idea. But oh, here was the frustrating thing. Actually, I didn't take it to the final. I got this far in, and the creative director on the project wanted me to change the angle on the piece. So he comes from film, So for him to say, like, we got to change the angle is no big deal. But for me to change the angle the way with my current process is literally a start over, right? There's no other way to do it. So he had me go back to the angle of that original sketch where it was really down low on the ground. After he actually changed it to it the other way first. So I didn't finish it until I had gone to this point. Right? So that was kind of a final piece. It's a pretty good example of what I would consider to be a final piece for them. And then in that particular room, if you remember the shot where we were looking down the other way, I actually ended up drawing one from the other way. It's actually two pieces. This is like a blown up version. And you can see the little skeleton guy down there. It's going to give you an idea of like scale-wise and where this thing. And like I said, these are, the intent for these is twofold. One is to get the art director, creative director, everyone on the same page. But the other intent is to pass it on to the 3D modelers that actually build this stuff. And I'll show you some of that, because that is probably where I spend most of my time is making, getting stuff ready for modelers, 3D modelers. Here's another project. This one is one that, the reason I kind of want to show you this is like how diverse my style needs to be, or how adept I need to be able to swap from style to style. It's a really important thing for me as a visual development guy, which is, it's a unique skill set. And when you hear people say, build your style, find what your style is, that's so important for if you want to be a children's illustrator, right? If you want to do visual development for film or for games, it is nice to be able to swap from style to style. So quite often I'll get to do crazy things like this. So I'll just show you a few pieces with this and some of the characters from it. So the idea for this world was it was kind of very polygonal. Everything in the whole entire world was very polygonal, was obviously not very from Earth. And to me, the thing that was fun about it is the first really highly colored piece that I was able to do with the void. A lot of the stuff is kind of natural and gritty and dark, and so I love color. Like if I could pick my palette from a pack of lifesavers, I'd be happy with that. That's my kind of color. As you can tell, because like, you know, I'm not shy about using color. This was really fun because it allowed me to use some of my figure drawing abilities, which you might be kind of surprised to me. I guess you can still see that's kind of figure drawing abilities. I kind of think things planarly, which was really a fun exercise for me to do. I really enjoyed this piece. I think when we were done, all told, I think I probably did about 35 or 40 finished illustrations for this one, and we canceled it. So totally, like, yeah, just be willing to do it. The good thing for me is that I ended up with some fun pieces. You know, so it was fun.
How do you cope with that?
I honestly don't care.
You don't?
I honestly don't. All right. And it's one of those things, I'll talk about it. The main reason that I don't care for that is that this for me is a job. I mean, it really honestly is. Like, if my intent with this was gallery work, it would be really hard for me to put it up and have people go, right? But this, my real objective here is to get them to make a decision early before they commit and put a ton of money into building the project. So I actually think that's kind of a success. Like, for me making 30 pieces is going to take me 2.5 or 3 months with another person kind of helping me, right? So that's really cheap for them to make that assessment early, right? Rather than say, let's throw 30 modelers on it and animators and everybody and then see if we like it. Like, if I can get them to communicate that through an image like this, it's great. And working with someone like The Void, which is a small startup company, is fun because they're pretty open about letting me show up places like this. Right? I don't post on my personal portfolio, it's their work, not mine. But it's nice for me to be able to kind of show them. And when I was a VA, that just doesn't happen. Like, I don't show up. And well, I haven't been there for a year, so I think this is only 2016, there's no VA work here. Same project. This one to me is really funny. These brown walls down at the bottom are human height. So these kind of stick walker guys are, you know, 100 feet tall, which would be brilliant in VR. Like to be able to walk around and see stuff and be like, oh my gosh, terrifying. But it's still the same point I wanted to fill. Terrifying from a creature standpoint, to me, anything spindly and long is always a little kind of uncomfortable. It does have that kind of eerie feeling to it. But color-wise, I want it to feel friendly and open, so it's just kind of fun dichotomy between the two. It's a really fun kind of piece.
Question about that.
Sure.
When they cancel projects like this, is it because of, like, they don't like the style that they've been developing, or
it's a myriad of reasons. Style-wise, they usually don't cancel based on style. They change the style and try a couple just to kind of see what it is. For this one in particular, they just didn't feel like it was broad enough appeal for an early project for them. They wanted something broad appeal, which I totally get. Like, this isn't going to appeal to as many people as if you do Dora the Explorer. Like, I mean, honestly, it's like, I don't want to draw Dora the Explorer. Like, oh, please don't make me do that. But they get a lot of people to come through and see it, right? Like, so there is kind of, once the void kind of builds what their brand is, they would probably jump all over something like this. I wouldn't be surprised if they come back to this one. Everybody loved it. We actually did take this one and build some prototype stuff. Because from a modeling standpoint, it's super fast and easy. Like, we can crank this stuff out. You know, it's really, really kind of basic modeling stuff. And I designed probably, I don't know, 30 or 40 critters, creatures of different sizes. You can kind of see, like, this guy was supposed to be huge, too. These lily pads are about 20 feet tall, so when you get the idea, when you see how far away he is, and you kind of, you have that nice moment where, you know, you get to make your scale relationship. You see these big, gigantic lily pads, and you see a guy clear out there with lily pads that are, you know, this big, and you know, wow, those are 20 feet tall. It feels big. And then this ends up being the kind of stuff that I use for presentation, right? So when I go talk to the art directors, I say, like, this type of character's on the pink side, they all kind of fit into this color palette. So this is like a color timing exercise, right? During this time of the experience, you're this type of color, maybe a little darker, kind of in here. But still, they all kind of fit within this homogeneous color palette. And these characters fit into these. And you can see those are pretty sketchy, right? And some of them I've taken past that point, but it was kind of an interesting image to kind of show. Okay, I'm gonna keep going. This is the one I didn't change the title on. You can't really do that. sorry. So Ghostbusters is a project we have live right now. It's at the Madame Tussauds building in Manhattan. The experience is actually live, which has been a lot of fun. I want to kind of show you a couple pieces from this to show you kind of my workflow if you're something like this. One thing, when I work with a group like this, it's kind of odd. I work with the Void, but still I was working with Sony, right? So Sony owns the Ghostbusters property. So for an extended period of time, I really wasn't even going into the Void. I was just working with the Sony Visual Development team and kind of taking some of their art assets and trying to figure out how to make it work. But at the same time, they didn't want it to be completely tied to the movie. They wanted it to be kind of its own thing. So this was the first piece. I probably did 25 or so at this level pieces. Maybe not that many, probably not. Probably more like 10 pieces at this level before. They felt like this one kind of captured the mood of what we were going for. So the interesting thing when you do this kind of like mood piece from a concept development standpoint is that unless you have like iconic set pieces and things that you can kind of root things around, a lot of it is just free exploration. And we knew that at one point in the experience we wanted the player, the user, the art guy, whatever, to walk out onto a scaffolding and look down to the streets of VR, right? That's a really great experience in VR to look down and get that kind of terrified thing. This was the first one that I did. But if I had this to a modeler, it leaves a lot of room for interpretation. Right? They could build this in a lot of different ways. Because you're like you can tell those are ropes, you can tell it's a bucket. The chains that are there are really out of scale, really, for what would probably work for something like that. And really, chains on a scaffolding is really kind of dumb. Like, physically, it doesn't make a lot of sense. So this stuff, it does serve a purpose. This is the first one that Sony approved and went, yeah, we kind of feel like you're heading in the right direction. So that was a good thing. But then I kind of immediately have to go back and I do a lot of these technical line drawings that I'll provide to modelers. So a modeler can take this and they can really build out the exact thing. And with this one, I also ended up redrawing like these little gearbox things down at the bottom from a different perspective because the modeler's like, I don't really know what you're doing here. And it kind of just depends on the modeler. Some modelers like to make that stuff up. Some of them would rather be like, when I make things up, I end up doing it two or three times, so you draw it. And once it's approved, we'll go. So I know for like these set pieces, I do draw a lot of these like really technical set pieces. Once again, it's kind of my still same school set perspective. And then at the same time, I did a bunch of these. These were a nightmare, but what a fun opportunity to have Ghostbusters, the guys who own the Ghostbusters franchise, say, we need you to design a new ghost. Like, it's like, oh my gosh, candy. It's like the best thing ever. I'm such a nerd for that stuff. So I do a bunch of these. And at the same level, right, like pages and pages and pages of these guys. They're really fun. These were all rejected. This one came close. This was my personal favorite one. Because I love the concept of These little guys, they've named them before. It's really common. Like, I get a script, like, here's what this guy does. So these are called nudgeons. So nudgeons were basically, they're the kind of guys that would inhabit a toaster, or they would live under your couch. They're very friendly. They live with humans. I had this idea of, like, if they live with humans, I could totally see them dressed in cast-off human things. Like, that would be what I would want to do. But Sony decided that they wanted them naked. So this was kind of like the final legend argument. The fun thing with this one is that not only are they an experience, which is great, to walk around and see, like, something you've drawn in, you know, it's great, it's fun, is that they've also made a toy. So Sony has a little toy you can buy at the legend at the Adam Dussault's things. That's fun. It's always fun to kind of see your stuff, kind of make that physical transition. But this is probably the most common thing that I do when I work with film, is I'll get stills from the movie. Most of you have probably seen the Ghostbusters movie, right? So I'll get stills from the movie. I got this probably a year before the movie came out. She's kind of a hero ghost in the show. In our experience, we have an 8-year-old version of her. So I kind of take her and be like, okay, it's going to be similar, but different. So that's super common. And when you work with film, they love to have, they're different than games. Games are like very kind of utilitarian art. Film loves to have move pieces. So the fun thing with film is you get to kind of create some of these type of things, right? Like, there it is in the scene. Like, they really respond well to this. So when you do meet her, you're in the basement with this little drop-down elevator, etc. So you get to kind of fun move pieces. And then who doesn't want to draw Slimer? It's the greatest thing ever. To explain, this is the best way to explain the void, right? So I'm going to walk you through this experience really quick. You walk in, you're with a group of other Ghostbusters, 3 or 4, depending on how many people go through. You literally have the Ghostbuster gun in your hands, right? You can shoot it, see your plasma thing go everywhere. You get into the, and you're a trainee, right? You're trying to become one of the Ghostbusters. When you get into the elevator, you have someone over your voice that's like, all right, trainee, we're going to turn off your thing so we don't want you to shoot. While we're going up in the elevators, too many electronics, we want things to go wrong. So they turn it off. When they turn it off, you're going up in the elevator. And it feels like you're going up. Like, it's bizarre. You bundle the floor a teeny bit. Those visuals really sell things really well. About halfway up, one of the guns, you know, randomly, pick one, we kind of jolt it a little bit, and it kind of goes haywire a little bit, and it buzzes out the control panel. Right? All video gaming kind of stuff. Right? When that happens, it stops mid-floor. And you see down this long hallway, this door opens, and you see Slimer down the hallway. And he's doing typical Slimer stuff, you know, shoving food in his face, being goofball. He turns around and sees you, and flies all the way towards you. Your guns don't work, you're freaking out, we bumble it even more, and when a ghost actually goes through you, we do two things. You're wearing a vest that's got what we call haptic monitors on them, and we buzz those, right? We can do it at all kinds of different frequencies, so it can feel like a pulse, it can feel like a gunshot, or it can feel like, so we buzz them, front first, back second, and it really feels like he's going through you. But at the same time, we missed you with a little tiny bit of just water, right? And it's the exact same time that he does his Slimer thing on you, so you feel like you've been slimed. It's an unbelievable experience. Like, in my entire career, I've never had anything like that. It's really, really fun. So that's really, that's the void. That is the void. We do those type of experiences all the time. Like, for example, when you smash the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man, we actually make it smell like marshmallow. Like, those are really fun kind of things. So anyway, that's kind of, I'm going to pop through just kind of quick. This is pretty common. I'll get, like, room design. This is what the actual layout of the section of the void would be. We would actually put that chair in there, so I'll do these quick sketches to kind of get the builders moving on these things, because they have to physically build them. This is a little bit more refined sketch. And then, luckily for this one, I got to do a more finished painting to kind of like set like the mood, like what it actually looks like. And this is the one that would go to the modelers. And then, when you're building a set piece like this, you can imagine there are tons of these type of things. Like, somewhere in the environment, when you can see the entire skyline, we want to have unique art assets. Right, we don't want to just be like, purchase a New York City skyline model set and put it into your Unity scene. And we can do that, but you know, we have all kinds of silly posters and I have a Stay Puft one, etc. And then sometimes you do stuff that's just like not good art. Like, that's ugly. Like, sorry, it's ugly. And then you talk to somebody and they're like, cool, let's make it uglier. And when your timeline is like, when your timeline on these kinds of things is a day or faster, you do, I ended up doing a lot of this kind of stuff. So, you know, I didn't draw these guys, I pulled them from internet reference, right, slapped them on top of my piece. I did the gun effects really quick because they're easy to do digitally, and that was enough. But it solved the problem, once again, right? Like, I certainly wouldn't want to hang out on the wall. It would be exact. And then, also, these are the ones we say, like, when does it hurt when it gets cut? These are the ones that hurt me. So, we had this great idea of, when you on your, in the basement apartment of this place, you look out the window and you can see these like kind of brownstone New York thing. And so I was just getting going on here, and I was just going to start drawing the Echo One, the Ghostbusters first, yeah. And they're like, oh, never mind, we're just going to put a brick wall there. It's like, oh, like kill a project, but don't make something. Like, you took something that could have been visually rich, and you turn it into a brick wall. That's a bummer. Okay. I'm probably going a little slow. I'm going to go through fast, right? This is typical. This is another project. This is one called Labyrinth Lot. The idea of the project is that in somebody's mind, every time they have a dream, this guy named something odd, it adds a room to this great tower. Yeah. So I did multiple versions of what that tower might be. This is one I'm currently working on, so I don't have very many pieces of this one. And those were all kind of like development pieces. This is kind of where we landed. This is what I'm currently working on, like today. I pulled this one today to kind of bring this up to you. So I'm just getting started. The tower needed to feel a little bit more hodgepodge and more iconic, and so that's kind of where that one is. It's kind of fun to see. This is another project. I'm kind of rooted in this monolithic thing lately, so I've been doing a lot of these. This is kind of a, it's called Stellar. That's the project name anyway. This is one I've been working on and off for about a year. It just keeps coming up, and so I'm constantly doing stuff like this. It's gone to a point where we're actually modeling some pieces, so I am doing some of these like more technical drawings. This is a good example of like, you know, kind of the town of drawings I'll do for something like that. I'll do these kind of technical drawings and get approved, and then I'll break it up into like, this section needs to be pulled out. Like this is kind of it. So I'll end up doing, if we end up doing this piece, I don't know if I will, probably hire a couple contractors to do this. We'll end up doing, I'm okay, literally thousands of pieces for a project like this before the model is built. And they all have to be drawn, every single one. And, you know, ship, discovery, so drawing lots of shapes. It's all that is, like perspective shape drawing, which I know you've all done in drawing one. This is what I like the most. The functionality was based on a lionfish, right? Like when it would slow up, it would kind of open up like a clamshell and fan out its wings to slow down. But we didn't do that. I'm gonna keep going. I love this one too, because I love space pirates, but nobody else seemed to like it. It's not just like functionality, that would be so cool. You put on the brakes and like literally put sails out. No. I'm gonna go fast. This is about where we landed. It's kind of this one. This one I called the Hopper. It's kind of like based on a frog kind of shape. We did a lot of discovery on that one. We ended up kind of smoothing it out eventually. These are all kind of typical stuff. I do multiple of these a day. This is where we landed probably most recently. This one, I could go on for a month about why this one doesn't work visually. But it's okay. It got us to a point where we could move on. And that's what we needed. We needed to get to a move on point. Because I needed to build some kind of set pieces. And this is the visual style that I'm kind of trying to convince him to go to, even though I personally want to have dark skies. That's a nice piece. Like, I'll be honest, I don't say that very often about my work, like, because I just don't have that time to kind of bite in. The crazy thing about this being nice is this is also super fast. Like, this is probably a 2-hour piece. Part of it is that I'd already had that ship done, right? I did it for a previous piece, so that's nice, that's just flipped. So I just had to do the background there, and that's really, really fast. You can learn a lot of tricks, and, you know, I can show you how to do it someday. It's pretty funny. And, you know, costume discovery, all kinds of stuff. I'm going to go real fast now. You get an idea. Like, this is kind of the workload that I get working as a full-time concept artist in an art studio. Like, I'm doing multiple projects at a time. I'm really trying to kind of dig into like the history of why things work. I rely heavily on art history. I'll give you an example of that in just a minute. And I pull very heavily on basically bringing in concept artists that have already done concept art, and I'll show you one right now that I'm currently working on. I'll tell you the artist's name. So actually, I'll see if you know what it is. Oh, and then if you're the guy who draws perspective, you are the guy that's like, hey, why don't you draw what the inside of our new building looks like, which is fun and terrifying at the same time. Oh, this was the suggestion for, my suggestion for the ceiling was a flat ceiling. Like, you look up and it's just flat. And they're like, no, draw this crazy curved girder thing. And they didn't realize that drawing receding ellipses is the worst thing on planet Earth. It's just so brutal. Because if you miss one, the whole thing looks like a nightmare. Look, flat ceiling. That's fast and easy. And this is where we ended up. Just more stuff, right? This is to kind of show you, like, from style to style, I need to be really flexible. I can't show you very many of this one. If you're creative, you'll figure out what it was for. But, you know, this is kind of, lots of line work. Oh my gosh, I don't get to do color as often as I want. This is the project that we're going to launch with. Watch for this one in the next couple of weeks. We'll probably make a big announcement. But this was kind of the first concept piece that I did to kind of set the initial mood, even though we've migrated quite a bit from that. It's not a Dustin Hansen palette, right? There's very few lifesavers in there. Kind of a bummer. But after that, then I do get into this. Like, you can go, this is production work. Like, drawing line art, and more line art, and more line art. Like, I crank these things out. And we do a lot of exploration. Like, these are two very different styles. And so even before I get to that line art stage, right, we do go through this exploration and say, like, does it want to be based on, like, 12th century Hindu art? Or does it want to be based on, you know, between 800 and 900 Polynesian art, right? There's a lot of similarities there. And from an art standpoint, I have to know that before I pass it off to modelers, because modelers, I love them, but if I don't give them enough reference, they'll find the prettiest thing that they find, which might be gorgeous, but it might not work for the whole project, right? So those are, like, both not in the right direction. This was one that actually did get approved. That's as far as I took it. We actually have a guy coming here March 2nd, a guy named Tori Blossom, our sculptor. He actually built this, and I'll see if he can, I'll ask him to bring it. So we actually, you know, built a physical version of it. So that was kind of the first thing, and this is a set piece that you'll see in the environment. You can actually pick it up, it's a little sculpture. Oh my gosh, I do so much of that. And so much of this kind of stuff to show, like, quick drawings of stages of something filling up. You would think that if you said, all right, it's this big cave that fills with water, everyone would think the same thing, but they don't. Like, everyone has a different vision of what that is. So I ended up drawing a lot of those kind of quick things. Oh my gosh, so many of these. Here's me using my palette. That got rejected. That's still me using my palette. This is kind of where we're at visually, as far as color and tone. This is not even an illustration, but it's effective illustration. And then once in a while, they leave me alone and let me draw something that I want to make a good illustration. This one was kind of fun, right? It turned out nice. And I probably only get to do, I would say, one of these a month. And I kind of selfishly pack them into my own schedule. I'm like, I have to paint something satisfying. Right? And not that the other work isn't satisfying, super fun. But every once in a while, I like to be able to kind of put in a little extra time and make something that is not just a good piece of production work, but it's a good image. Right? It's fun to do. Okay, anyone know the artist? No, it's not Sarabha. Similar time period.
Sargent?
No.
Mm-hmm. Herbert.
He's a kind of obscure guy. This is a guy named John Atkinson Brinkshaw. He is one of my very favorites. Oh my gosh. The interesting thing about him is if I could hire him as a concept artist for this next project I'm working on, I would do it today. Unfortunately, he died in 1893. So it's really, really pricey. Like, you can still get it. That's no problem. You should have paid even those. Seances and everything. This is the stuff, this is the kind of the mood board that I pulled. I have one that's more specific. This is literally a Google image search. But I really wanted to capture that sense of atmosphere. And I kind of jokingly said he's kind of the anti-Kincaid, because instead of the painter of light, he's the painter of dark, which is 10 times harder like everyone can paint flowers. Painting dark is nice. Because these are all night scenes, but they have really high value to keep. It's really hard to do. So I'll show you like my process to get to this. I do a ton of sketches. This is hard for me because it's intentionally broken perspective. So there's multiple perspectives in here, but they kind of fit the design of the game. So I kind of get to this point where I'm doing these, you know, like really quick and dirty drawings to kind of get to here. I had to do a dock, and I'll show you this dock shipyard one. And I also, at the same time, had to do like a Victorian-ish city. We skewed it. The art director wanted to see what if it was skewed even further, so that's kind of, you know, really quick. Literally, while he's sitting there at my desk, we pull it apart, Photoshop, and skew it some more. If you're familiar with the tool, you realize that's like instantaneous minutes. We decided this was better. So after I did that, then I do a kind of a quick lay-in for color and some detail. And by quick, that's half a day, you know, 3 or 4 hours to kind of do that. And then I'll do what I call like a mood piece, right? So to me, this is a successful thing. It's not quite Grimshaw color palette, but it's close. The void tends to like things a little darker. But now that I can go back and say, but what if we add Grimshaw to that? Then I can go and I can push that to that same color palette and that same value key. And it's more contrasty because you're down in the city, and then with fog, you know, obviously you might have more contrast. But, you know, that fall off where you can see Big Ben, you can still kind of see that it's somewhat silhouetted. It kind of has that Grimshaw feeling to it. And as far as, like, this is another good example of, I'm going to show you like the detail shots on these. Like, they're pretty high res. These are big pieces. Then I put those two pieces together because in the game, when you look one direction, you'd be able to see like the Victorian thing, and then we have kind of a swimmy, black, dark fog thing, and you look another direction, you can see down the dock. So it's kind of part of like, playing with virtual reality. So that's kind of, it's a hodgepodge. It's intentionally like multiple perspectives, which drives me bonkers, but it's kind of interesting. And then this is kind of my typical process. Like, this is what I'm currently working on here. The one on the left is where it was a couple of days ago. And these are just notes to myself after. Like, I'm just like every other artist, right? I paint something, I have to walk away from it for a little while to realize what's wrong with it. And when I go back, if I don't write down those notes for me of what I need to fix, I'll forget. And I'll start painting again, and for some reason my brain gets caught in painter mode and not thinker mode, and I'll mess it up. And so I've done this piece for a while, so I left it for a day, and then wrote myself these notes, right, with real simple stuff, right? And then I did a really fast color one over the top. So to me, that one on the right is the closest to the Grimshaw look that I've gotten so far. So that's the direction I'll head with this project. And that's original. Okay, now we're gonna go really fast. I keep saying that.
Yeah.
Minotaur project is kind of the one that I kind of showed you. You know, these are massive, massive paintings. These are fun. I'm just gonna literally go through. These are fun. This project didn't have anyone to kind of champion it, so I was able to, so I need to do better illustrations. I mean, that's what it comes down to, right? Like, I could spend the time on it. So these are kind of fun. I really do like these. These are the quick sketches of the hallway. This was the one that I had at the beginning. And this a piece like this, I'm spending a good week on a piece like this. So that includes like pulling the reference, making sure I have the time period properly. You know, doing multiple sketches to get the right angle, and then going and actually doing painting. So that's a good week's worth of work. And then, you know, I also do a lot of stuff because I'm bored at home. I'm going to quickly talk about this because I want to show you. I'm sorry. I said it was going to be fast. I should have put 150 slides on something. So this one I did to set a goal for myself. And I'm sure you guys have done this in the past. And this really came to the point, if you haven't done it, do it. This is really an important part of the creative process. And it is find holes or weaknesses in your drawing ability and fill them with a project. And I'm serious about a project, right? Whether that's an assignment, whatever. Talk to your instructors and say, hey, I know this is the assignment. Here's what I'm trying to fix. Can we integrate it? I guarantee they'll work with it. That's what this is. So here it is for me. I am a horrible cartoonist. But it comes up all the time in my career. People all the time are asking me to do stuff like this, and I'm just terrible at it. So I knew the only way for me to get better at this was to put something on my plate that would allow me to do it. And I like to write, so I kind of had these fun Jurassic Park, Tiny I Shrunk the Kids concept in my mind. And I worked with my agent. I have an agent that helps me find a lot of this work too, by the way, which is kind of a little discussion. And I said, I want to do this. This is something I want to do. And she's like, great, I need some art to go out to people with. The concept will work. We can probably sell the concept. I need some art to go out with. So this is the art that I went out with. And it's BAD. Like, it is. It's just not good, right? these are the pieces that I went out with. I had four or five others. The one that I went out with that worked, I'll show you, it was an environment piece. Big shocker. I thought that was the one where you're like, oh, yeah, that'll work. And these are kind of out of order, but I did a lot of development on, like, how do I draw a cartoony dinosaur and still let anatomy be part of the puzzle? So I did a lot of this. That little dinosaur in the middle, the black and white one, is by an artist named Piper Thibodeau. She's brilliant. She did a thing where she's drawing a different little character every single day. I think she's on day 1400 or something, never missed a day. Her stuff's great, and I liked it from the cartoony standpoint, but it lacked anatomy for me. I like to have things a little bit more anatomical. Correct. So that's kind of like me looking at hers. You know, I put a lot of reference on things, and I wanted to see what real dinos look like, etc. Then I kind of break them down to these little bone drawings, and I did pages and pages of these until I can do them without reference, like kind of get them into my brain. This was the characters that I went out with to do the submission, and they're okay. I mean, they're okay. I think it's it's good enough to give you the contract, so that's good, right? It was kind of the first, like, action piece that I had for the submission, and same thing, I mean, it was okay. I would say that Triceratops lacks anatomy, right? I'm going to beat up a year ago Dustin, that's what I'd say. Get your anatomy right. But, you know, big shocker, like, when it comes to drawing perspective, I'm still okay. Like, those skill sets transfer. Those are things that transfer. And the real truth is, I just haven't done figure drawing in 20 years. So it's something I've been very rusty on. A lot of these. But this one right here was the first piece that I did that I felt like, okay, I can attack this project. It's very different visually from my normal work. It's really fun for me to kind of learn. So I jumped in. So it was that piece and this one were the first two where I felt like, okay, I can do this. So I signed up the book contract. There's 100 illustrations in the book. And that was a bit more than I was ready for, to be honest. This is the final one that went into the book. And I'm going to pick it apart a little bit. This one, it just came down to time. That's just really what it is. I bit off more than I could chew. And the anatomy in especially the bird dinosaur, right, is just really not working. It's an okay piece. I think it's successful. Once again, it answers the problem. Like if you read what's going on in that section, it's fun. Kids will respond to it. But it could be so much better. And during the project, even though I knew that this stuff, like, it had a deadline. When the deadline's there, we're going to print. I knew that there were going to be some things that I had to live with, right? So sometimes it's kind of that, like, how do you know when it's done? How do you, like, get it? It's almost like a cancellation thing. Eventually, I'm like, I have to let it go. So that one's in the book, and I'm not terribly happy with it. And this was one of the few there's a lot of them. This is one in the book that kind of set my goals for book two. And that's what I really want to finish talking about. It's like, what does book two do? What did I learn from book one that I put into book two? And what did I forget? And so those were big questions that I asked myself, you know, after I looked at this like collection of 100 pieces and went, let's sum it up. I can rank them. This is my favorite. This is my least favorite. And I do that stuff because I'm an artist, right? We beat each other. We beat each other and ourselves up a lot. Sometimes ourselves more than others. The reason I like this one is I do like the anatomy. I like the pose, but it's not enough, right? Like, I would like to increase the S curve of her back a little bit. There are some things I'd like to do. Give her, she's supposed to feel weightless. She's jumping on a skateboard. She kind of does. Could be better. So I went to my biggest influence, which is always design. Always for me. It's really where my shortcomings come. So I decided that the main problem I needed to fix, number one, was to fix the design so that the pieces felt more designed. So I went back to, this is just where I go. I'm a huge fan of Japanese brush painting. So these five pieces are the five that I pulled out. Believe it or not, I pulled out the stereotype piece, right? But it worked for what I needed. And some of this was line work, right? Like, the line work in this cut is so good, and my book was missing. And then this was kind of the other one, is things that I missed was this potential for overlap to build better, more believable perspective, and how simple that is. Like, value key-wise, their overlap doesn't change. Like, it's just overlap. That's all it is. You could take all the value out of this and it still work. Just a little bit. And then this one, like, really nice attention paid to both form and matter, which looks like it's a blob. It's incredible. So these are a few pieces from the new book, kind of trying to use some of those things to integrate that and to take those things that are important and influential to me and put them into my new current art. So these are shots from book two that use some of those design principles. And the other one I was trying to fix was better and happy. So I did spend a lot of time kind of redrawing. I've done a lot of figure drawing this year to kind of get there. And some of them are starting to work, starting to pay off. Like, I do like this piece. This one has, it's got nice balance, it has a nice design. And also the other thing I've really tried to bump up is my brush work. And so the quality of the line itself is really important. So a couple of things. I've pushed it from 100 illustrations in book two to 80, or from 100 in book one to 80 to book two. So that helped. And gave myself a little bit more time. And I really wanted to make sure that I got weight into my characters. So even in a really static pose, I wanted to make sure I had that weight. And so that's been something you get from figure drawing. That's just it. Even cartoons, right? That's where it comes from. Same thing, right? I wanted that nice pushback. Multiple drawings to get to that one. But this one in particular is probably one of my favorites in the book for those same reasons, right? The overlap is in there, right? I love the flat backgrounds. So that's been a big push for me. It's kind of risky because the art style from book one to book two are slightly different. I know somebody will, you guys will know now. Some people will see it. I'm hoping that they'll just look at it and say, it's better. Right?
Hey!
Kind of, that's what I'm hoping for. And this is that same thing. Like, overlap works really well. Trying to get different perspectives in there that are unique. And trying to take that concept of good figure drawing, even all the way to like facial expressions, etc. Right? Just trying to make sure that we get those proper. And you know, they just feel more alive, a little bit more action, a little bit more design. And you know, you can see where the Japanese painting design influence is definitely part of the kind of where I ended up. Better anatomy is a big goal. Actually, if I could pull this one up with the previous drawing of that same bird, you'll see the anatomy changes that I've made. Right? Like, I wanted to have that tail feel like it had weight underneath her body. And I wanted to have that big thigh muscle at the top show through the feathers. I wanted to have enough separation between the clavicle in the front of the bird and the hips in the back, which when you look at those skeletons, they're really close together. But they're all covered in feathers, like how do you do that? So that was kind of a big challenge. I went back really quickly too. But it's always good to look at that art, right? Especially when it's yours, you can figure out art. And anatomy-wise, that's a nice improvement, I think. So I'm hoping that I can kind of do those things. So really it's that idea of never being satisfied with good enough, because that's what they say. Good is the passive brother of great, I think is kind of what it is. Right? So book one's good. I'm totally pleased with it. I want it to be great, so I'm really trying to kind of push that kind of stuff. Never, ever, ever draw a book where you have to draw RC cars. It's back to that same problem of receding ellipses, and now you're adding knocking tires. It is a nightmare. All right, and that's it.